Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Our today's lecture is about posture, which is again a very important topic and a very important thing to discuss, because when we talk about the posture, nobody can deny the importance of posture, because there is a famous proverb saying a posture follows the body like a shadow. Whatever the position we opt in our daily lives, doing any activity or even during resting, it starts or ends with the posture. So this is basically or actually a position which a person opts during 24 hours of the day. So now we see in detail what a posture is like. Posture is the attitude assumed by the body. Now what is meant by attitude? The shape, the contour, the aura a body opts whenever resting or performing an activity. Movement starts and ends in a posture. A person wants to stand, that's a standing is a posture. A person wants to sit from a standing position, the standing position was a posture and the sitting position was a posture. A person wants to take the rest, the standing position was the posture, the sitting position was the posture. And if a person assumes a lying position, that lying position itself is a posture. So when we talk about the posture, we talk about the position the human body assumes. And what is the importance of that position? It position should be favorable to the human body. It should lie the minimal muscular pressure on human body, and the productivity of any position should be maximum. Suppose a person has opted the standing posture to perform some activity. Say he wants to post a letter. So his standing position should be so much efficient that he can write, he can post, or he can deliver that thing to the purpose which he was trying to do. So it means we have to look after the posture very efficiently. We have to assess the posture very efficiently. So we can add the elements which are missing in the actual good posture, and we can add those elements. Basically, a posture is divided into two categories: inactive posture, in which a person is performing less activity or no activity, and the active posture, which requires the continuous changing of position and purpose. Now we see the inactive posture. What is meant by inactive posture? Inactive posture is a posture in which the person's activity has been reduced to minimal, right? Suppose a person is taking rest, whether he is in lying position or is in the sitting position. Both positions are called resting position until unless he is not doing some other activity. Secondly, sleep. Sleep is the moment where a person takes rest, and most of the time it is in the lying position. So in this position, a person's muscles are working. Which muscles? The anti-gravity muscles. But the rest of the non-postural muscles, they are in rest position, and at the result, the movement is minimal. The muscle activity is reduced to minimal. Why? Because there are no external demands on the body. Person has not to provide some task, he has not to speak, he has not to perform some activity, he has not to change his position. He has to make his body calm and in lying position. Thirdly, posture should put minimal demand on respiratory muscles, blood circulation and lymphatic flow. Even though we assume an inactive posture, suppose if a person is lying in prone position, he is performing no activity, but this prone position will not be an efficient posture. Why? Because it will enhance the respiratory demands. So even in the form of inactive posture, we suggest our patient to assume a certain posture. We should keep in our mind that a posture should be such that their respiratory efficiency shall be maximum, their blood circulation should be uninterrupted, their lymphatic flow should be uninterrupted and good to go. So it means The elements of a posture are not only about the neuromuscular system, but we have to look after the other systems as well, which take part in the muscular efficiency of human body. So when we talk about these three elements, the respiratory muscles should be calm and there should be less effort on breathing, blood circulation should be uninterrupted, or lymphatic flow should be in a go. So it means we have to look after which is the ideal posture for this. The first thought which comes in mind is like it should be a lying posture. But in lying position, when we discuss the basic fundamental positions of the human body, we had discussed that the sole lying position is not favorable for respiration because there is a great burden on diaphragm and the respiratory effort is somewhat enhanced in that position. So the ideal position should be somewhat between lying and standing. So what can be that position? The ideal position which we use for general body relaxation, and this posture is called the half lying position. And half lying position should be assumed in such that as a lady is in half lying position, the trunk is supported in the oblique position by inclination of the long end of the plinth. The ideal angle for performing this position is around 45 degrees. Or by the arrangement of pillows, if the head of the bed is not tiltable, we can use pillows, one pillow, two pillow, three pillow, according to the patient's requirement. The legs should be supported horizontally, the foot should be rest at some place, and the ideal position will be to add some support in the form of pillow or towel or some other soft element below the both knees, so that there should be no curve below the knees and knee should be well rested. As far as the arms are concerned, there is a better position if arm should be at the side. It can be an armchair, or you can place two pillows on the side of the patient, so his arm can be well rest on that. So it means it is important to see that the trunk is in alignment to avoid slumping and so impeding respiration. So this is a well-designed position, both favoring the respiration and both performing the purpose of inactive or restful posture. So now you have to identify what are the key benefits we take from the inactive posture. Think about in terms of reducing muscular spasm, reducing fatigue, providing rest to the certain muscles, refilling your physiological fuel, and thinking about the movement and re-energizing the human body. So I have given you certain clues. Your answer can revolve around this, and my next assignment will be related to this. So you have to identify the benefits which a person can gain from the inactive posture. Next comes the active posture. So it is self-explanatory what we should understand from active posture. An active posture will lead to the activity. Activity can be anything which a person desires. Actually, it is result of integrated action of many muscles, a position adopted by body during different movements. As far as the inactive posture was concerned, the main muscles which were responsible for maintaining the inactive posture were anti-gravity muscles. But in form of active posture, right from the anti-gravity muscles, right from the stabilizer, right from the flexor, right from the extensor, every muscle of the human body is involved somewhere to execute that single activity. When we talk about integrated action of many muscles, suppose a person just want to have a walk. So a walk can mainly led by his lower limb muscles. Suppose he is using his hip flexors, knee flexors, toes. His movement is happening on his ankle joint. His trunk is supporting him, and in the walking process, his arms are swinging by the side so he can perform the activity of walk smoothly. But in a simple act of walk, every muscle of the body is taking place respiratory muscles are doing their part because the respiratory demands are somehow increased. So it means every muscle of the body is integrating its action to produce a fruitful movement or activity. So when we talk about the active posture, we have to assess all the elements which are contributing in maintaining that posture. Mainly, there are two main types which can be studied under the umbrella of active posture. One is static posture and the other one is dynamic posture. Static posture is one, somewhat we can take it as our inactive posture, but it cannot be restful or sleepy posture. State of equilibrium is maintained. How? Muscles act two way. One, the muscles stabilize the joints, and secondly, they work against gravity. Suppose a person is in standing position and his job requirement, or somehow he is a baker, he is a policeman, he is a guard performing duty at some doorstep. His job activity mainly required for performing or opting a posture for extended hours or length of time. So what is needed there? One thing is needed to stabilize the joint, whether the activity is taking place. A person performing hand wrestling maneuver, although only his wrist muscles or forearm muscles are working, his elbow joint is being stabilized by certain muscles. His shoulder joint, which is the proximity of this activity, is being stabilized by certain muscles. His trunk position, whether by sitting on a restful chair or a non-supported chair, whole body requires a certain integration to perform that activity. Secondly, his anti-gravity muscles are working constantly to work against the gravity. It means we have to perform this activity in certain demanding environment that our muscles have to collaborate one another and side by side, stabilizing the joint and making the movement potential maximized. So here is an example of three pictures, the frontal view, the side view and the back view, where we can see on which levels we can assess a posture, a static posture. Suppose a person is standing facing us and we will see how his active posture is being maintained. His ears are at level, shoulders are at level, hip joints are at level, knees are at level. Similar is the way with side view. There are no slumps or hitches in the spine. Similar with the back view, we can see every bony alignment is correct and there are no tilts at terms of spines and ears, shoulder, hip joint and knee, they are at same level. So this is example of not only the good posture but the ideal posture. Next comes the dynamic posture. When we talk about the dynamic posture, the dynamic means movement. The pattern is constantly modified and adjusted. Why? Because activity is constantly changing. If a person is running, if a person is typing, continuously his finger movements are changing, his step movements are changing. It means every time when his foot is being placed on the ground, there should be a different demand, whether it will be a smooth road, it should be a bumpy road. Every time the balance requirement will be changed and the requirement by the person will be changed. Whether he changes his speed, whether he changes his route, whether he changes his type of running, everything will be changed. Adapted as the movement demands. If a person is standing or is performing some hurdle race, some hurdles will require a greater muscular effort, a greater height of jump. Some hurdles will require a low jump. Some hurdles will require the curling of the body. So it means there will be a change in demand. There will be a change in the posture according to that demand. And this dynamic posture forms an efficient base of the movement. How? Because as the demand changes, the body constantly makes an arrangement for that demand and opts that posture within minutes. Here is an example of some origami art where a human body can be seen performing different postures or assuming different postures from a higher stable position to a least stable position where whole body weight is carried by a single arm, which is height of stability and equilibrium. In every position, there is a different demand which has been put on the body, and according to that demand, the body and the muscles involve in that activity and assume their posture. So this is all for today's lecture. Inshallah, in next lecture, we will talk in detail how different neuromuscular elements take part in assuming a posture.